This is the Voice of Freedom. Listening to the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network. You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, the man of the hour has labeled me in a White House memo as the most dangerous radio host in America. Why? Well, because I wield the sword of truth. And anytime you tell the truth, it makes everyone mad, especially those who lie, deceive, and manipulate. And that certainly fits William Jefferson Clinton and his round table of socialist lackeys. We're going to be talking about the inauguration today, about Mr. Clinton's speech, and about what it portends. What is the message that he is giving us? Even though he has coated it with sugar, ladies and gentlemen, and has tried to appeal to what feels good in all of us, the message remains the same.
Never in human history has so few taken so much from so many as America's Illuminati and their warlords of Wall Street and Washington. In just 8 years, these banksters and international government gangsters took us from the greatest creditor nation to the largest debtor nation on earth. Our standard of living has dropped like a rock for 4 out of every 5 Americans. They're foreclosed on our homes, our farms, our factories. They've exported your jobs and surrendered our arms. A new world order. prosecuted as slaves from birth to grave. The bank is on the Federal Reserve. It's private. They own it. It's neither federal nor reserve. The cashes make them do that funny money stuff you call dollars for two centuries. They lend it back to us at full face value. They charge you interest. You get the debt. They get the interest. They get the gold. You get the share. The FBI, the ATF, and the NDA, they don't give a damn about the POWs, the MIA. Hillary can get Marx and Mao. They want it all. They want it all. They want it now. The Illuminati imports the dope. They create the chaos. Bring us up. They create it. It's their designer disease. Bring you down. The global culture. They want to vaccinate your child and give them the mark. They want to eliminate you and shoot you in the dark. They want you to pay for it with plastic under your soul. They want you under their thumb. I'll be here in control. A new world order. A new world order. A new world order.
Ladies and gentlemen, that should set the tone for what is coming. I wanted to record the inaugural address of President Clinton this morning so that I could play that back to you verbatim in his own voice, but somehow I missed it. I thought that it was going to occur a little bit later in the proceedings, and I did not get an opportunity to tape it. So I'm going to read it to you. I have it verbatim. As usual, we have people all over the country who... You see, we take what the Associated Press and the White House puts out that they say he's going to say, and we have people that are there when the speech is given, transcribing it verbatim, so that if he changes even one word, we have it. So what I'm going to read to you right now is going to be the exact speech in the exact words verbatim that President Clinton gave as his inaugural address. And it is extremely interesting. It shows two things. One, how ignorant he is about the truth of this nation. And he tells us in sort of a symbolic language what we can expect in the future. And both of these revelations are really scary, ladies and gentlemen. Now, if you don't know anything about the symbolism of the New World Order, if you don't know anything about the history of this country, you probably sat and listened to this entire inaugural address and got all this sugary, feely-goody feeling about what he was talking about, not really understanding what it is that he has really said. And so that's what we're going to discuss, and later on we'll open the phones and get your input. See what you feel about this inaugural address and the promise of the next 4 years. And here it is, verbatim. I will not deviate. I will not stop and add any of my comments. I will read this straight through, and you can pretend that my blonde hair has been dyed silver and that I have that silly little smirk on the edge of my mouth that he always has, and that I'm speaking in his whiny little voice. If you can do that, then you can get the gist of the atmosphere that this speech was given within. And I quote, "My fellow citizens, at this last presidential inauguration for the 20th century," well, let me back up because I said I would do it verbatim, so let me do that. And I quote again, "My fellow citizens, at this last presidential inauguration of the 20th century, let us lift our eyes toward the challenges that await us in the next century. It is our good fortune that time and chance have put us not only at the edge of a new century in a new millennium, but on the edge of a bright new prospect in human affairs. A moment that will define our course and our character for decades to come. We must keep our old democracy forever young. Guided by the ancient vision of a promised land, let us set our sights upon a land of new promise. The promise of America was born in the 18th century out of the bold conviction that we are all created equal. It was extended and preserved in the 19th century when our nation spread across the continent, saved the Union, and abolished the awful scourge of slavery. Then in turmoil and triumph, that promise exploded onto the world stage to make this the American century. And what a century it has been. America became the world's mightiest industrial power, saved the world from tyranny in two world wars and a long Cold War, and time and again reached out across the globe to millions who longed for the blessings of liberty. Along the way, Americans produced the great middle class and security in old age, built unrivaled centers of learning, and opened public schools to all, split the atom and explored the heavens, invented the computer and the microchip, and deepened the wellspring of justice by making a revolution in civil rights for African Americans and all minorities, and extending the circle of citizenship, opportunity, and dignity to women. Now, for the third time, a new century is upon us, and another time to choose. We began the 19th century with a choice to spread our nation from coast to coast. We began the 20th century with a choice to harness the Industrial Revolution to our values of free enterprise, conservation, and human decency. Those choices made all the difference. At the dawn of the 21st century, a free people must now choose to shape the forces of the information age and the global society, to unleash the limitless potential of all our people, and yes, to form a more perfect union. When last we gathered, our march to this new future seemed less certain than it does today. We vowed then to set a clear course, to renew our nation. In these 4 years, we have been touched by tragedy, exhilarated by challenge, strengthened by achievement. America stands alone as the world's indispensable nation. Once again, our economy is the strongest on earth. Once again, we are building stronger families, thriving communities, better educational opportunities, a cleaner environment. Problems that once seemed destined to deepen now bend to our efforts. Our streets are safer, and record numbers of our fellow citizens have moved from welfare to work. And once again, we have resolved for our time a great debate over the role of government. Today, we can declare, government is not the problem, and government is not the solution. We, the American people, we are the solution. Our founders understood that well and gave us a democracy strong enough to endure for centuries, flexible enough to face our common challenges and advance our common dreams. As times change, so government must change. We need a new government for a new century, humble enough not to try to solve all our problems for us, but strong enough to give us the tools to solve our problems for ourselves. A government that is smaller, lives within its means, and does more with less, yet where it can stand up for our values and interests around the world, and where it can give Americans the power to make a real difference in their everyday lives. Government should do more, not less. The preeminent mission of our new government is to give all Americans an opportunity, not a guarantee, but a real opportunity to build better lives. Beyond that, my fellow citizens, the future is up to us. Our founders taught us that the preservation of our liberty and our union depends upon responsible citizenship, and we need a new sense of responsibility for a new century. There is work to do. Work that government alone cannot do. Teaching children to read, hiring people off welfare rolls, coming out from behind locked doors and shuttered windows to help reclaim our streets from drugs and gangs and crime, taking time out of our own lives to serve others. Each and every one of us, in our own way, must assume personal responsibility, not only for ourselves and our families, but for our neighbors and our nation. Our greatest responsibility is to embrace a new spirit of community for a new century. For any one of us to succeed, we must succeed as one America. The challenge of our past remains the challenge of our future. Will we be one nation, one people, with one common destiny, or not? Will we all come together or come apart? The divide of race has been America's constant curse, and each new wave of immigrants gives new targets to old prejudices. Prejudice and contempt, cloaked in the pretense of religious or political conviction, are no different. These forces have nearly destroyed us in the past. They plague us still. They fuel the fanaticism of terror, and they torment the lives of millions in fractured nations all around the world. These obsessions cripple both those who hate and, of course, those who are hated, robbing both of what they might become. We cannot, we will not, succumb to the dark impulses that lurk in the far regions of the soul everywhere. We shall overcome them, and we shall replace them with the generous spirit of a people who feel at home with one another. Our rich texture of racial, religious, and political diversity will be a godsend in the 21st century. Great rewards will come to those who can live together, learn together, work together, forge new ties that bind together. As this new era approaches, we can already see its broad outlines. 10 years ago, the Internet was the mystical province of physicists. Today, it is a commonplace encyclopedia for millions of schoolchildren. Scientists now are decoding the blueprint of human life. Cures for our most feared illnesses seem close at hand. The world is no longer divided into two hostile camps. Instead, we are building bonds with nations that once were our adversaries. Growing connections of commerce and culture give us a chance to lift the fortunes and spirits of people the world over. And for the very first time in all of history, more people on this planet live under democracy than dictatorship. My fellow Americans, as we look back at this remarkable century, we may ask, can we hope not just to follow, but even to surpass the achievements of the 20th century in America and to avoid the awful bloodshed that stained its legacy? To that question, Every American here and every American in our land today must answer a resounding yes. This is the heart of our task. With a new vision of government, a new sense of responsibility, a new spirit of community, we will sustain America's journey. The promise we sought in a new land, we will find again in a land of new promise. In this new land, education will be every citizen's most prized possession. Our schools will have the highest standards in the world, igniting the spark of possibility in the eyes of every girl and every boy, and the doors of higher education will be open to all. The knowledge and power of the information age will be within reach not just to the few, but of every classroom, every library, every child. Parents and children will have time not only to work, but to read and play together. And the plans they make at their kitchen table will be those of a better home, a better job, the certain chance to go to college. Our streets will echo again with the laughter of our children because no one will try to shoot them or sell them drugs anymore. Everyone who can work will work with today's permanent underclass part of tomorrow's growing middle class. New miracles of medicine at last will reach not only those who can claim care now, but the children and hardworking families too long denied. We will stand mighty for peace and freedom and maintain a strong defense against terror and destruction. Our children will sleep free from the threat of nuclear, chemical, or biological weapons. Ports and airports, farms and factories will thrive with trade and innovation and ideas. And the world's greatest democracy will lead a whole world of democracies. Our land of new promise will be a nation that meets its obligations, a nation that balances its budget, but never loses the balance of its values. A nation where our grandparents have secure retirement and health care, and their grandchildren know we have made the reforms necessary to sustain those benefits for their time. A nation that fortifies the world's most productive economy, even as it protects the great natural bounty of our water, air, and majestic land. And in this land of new promise, we will have reformed our politics so that the voice of the people will always speak louder than the din of narrow interests, regaining the participation and deserving the trust of all Americans. Fellow citizens, let us build that America, a nation ever moving forward toward realizing the full potential of all its citizens. Prosperity and power. Yes, they are important, and we must maintain them. But let us never forget the greatest progress we have made and the greatest progress we have yet to make is in the human heart. In the end, all the world's wealth and 1,000 armies are no match for the strength and decency of the human spirit. 34 years ago, the man whose life we celebrate today spoke to us down there at the other end of this mall in words that moved the conscience of a nation. Like a prophet of old, he told of his dream that one day America would rise up and treat all its citizens as equals before the law and in the heart. Martin Luther King's dream was the American dream. His quest is our quest, the ceaseless striving to live out our true creed. Our history has been built on such dreams and labors, and by our dreams and labors we will redeem the promise of America in the 21st century. To that effort, I pledge all my strength and every power of my office. I ask the members of Congress here to join in that pledge. The American people returned to office a president of one party and a Congress of another. Surely they did not do this to advance the politics of petty bickering and extreme partisanship they plainly deplore. No, they call all of us instead to be repairers of the breach and to move on with America's mission. America demands and deserves big things from us, and nothing big ever came from being small. Let us remember the timeless wisdom of Cardinal Bernardin when facing the end of his own life. He said, quote, "It is wrong to waste the precious gift of time on acrimony and division," end quote. Fellow citizens, we must not waste the precious gift of this time. For all of us are on that same journey of our lives, and our journey too will come to an end, but the journey of our America must go on. And so, my fellow Americans, we must be strong, for there is much to dare. The demands of our time are great, and they are different. Let us meet them with faith and courage, with patience and a grateful, happy heart. Let us shape the hope of this day into the noblest chapter in our history. Yes, let us build our bridge, a bridge wide enough and strong enough for every American to cross over to a blessed land of new promise. May those generations whose faces we cannot yet see, whose names we may never know, say of us here that we led our beloved land into a new century with the American dream alive for all her children, with the American promise of a more perfect union a reality for all her people, with America's bright flame of freedom spreading throughout all the world. From the height of this place and the summit of this century, let us go forth. May God strengthen our hands for the good work ahead and always bless our America. Thank you. exactly years ago what it was that William Jefferson Clinton said in his speech today. You just heard it. But in case you're confused or don't understand it, let me explain it to you, and I'm going to quote directly from the tenets, the teachings of Adam Weishaupt, who founded the Illuminati, and Clinton Roosevelt. In fact, I will just continue where I left off with the series on Weishaupt's order. And here we go. The Columbian Lodge of the Order of Illuminati emerged into the open once again as the Columbian Lodge of the Masonic Order about 1838. High in its ranks was Assemblyman Clinton Roosevelt, a descendant of Clise Martinson Van Roosevelt and his wife, Janet J. Samuels Clinton Roosevelt. His cousin of more than a dozen United States presidents, including Theodore Roosevelt, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, John Quincy Adams, James Madison, and Martin Van Buren, all members of the Roosevelt Delano dynasty. And you can read The Strange Death of Franklin D. Roosevelt, printed by the Chedney Press in 1948, for more information about that. And that dynasty calls itself America's Royal Family. The dynasty owes to the Illuminist, Socialist, Communist, Liberal conspiracy its rise to power. Its continuance in power rests on its leadership in that conspiracy. Equally important, ladies and gentlemen, is the control of the nominating machinery of both major political parties, and generally of all parties, held by the Roosevelt-Delano dynasty since the founding of our republic. And this has permitted them to mock and deride the nation's pretense to self-rule. You see, your vote really doesn't count if they choose the candidates and all of the candidates are in their pocket. Doesn't make any difference who you vote for. You should have realized that by now. Cousin John Adams was a founder of the Federalist Party, antecedent of the Republican Party, and from its beginning, he gained control of its nominating machinery for his kinsmen of the dynasty. Cousin Martin Van Buren, as running mate of Andrew Jackson, was one of the founders of the Democratic Party. He gained control of the nominating machinery of the Democratic Party for his dynastic kinsmen, and they have retained it ever since. Since then, the dynasty has gained control of the nominating machinery of every new party that came into being, whether liberal, labor, communist, socialist, bull moose, Whig, or Republican, or any of the others that have emerged on the local scene. Traditionally, they have shown no loyalty except to their selfish interests. No religion or party has ever held their adherents. Almost every third party movement in our history has been launched by a disgruntled member of the dynasty seeking to assert his claim to public office or in order to split the vote to ensure that a particular candidate is chosen over all others. On October 29, 1835, Clinton Roosevelt and his powerful associates and Illuminist fellow conspirators, who were members of Tammany Hall, undertook to take control of Tammany and impress its organization into the furtherance of their plot. The way had been prepared for this move by the agitation stirred up by a British female Illuminist, Frances Fanny Wright, who came to this country in 1829 to give a series of lectures at Masonic Hall. She advocated the entire Illuminist program of her auxiliary of the Order of Illuminati, including communism made more palatable by the label of, quote, equal opportunity and equal rights, end quote, atheism, emancipation of women, and free love. She had won a large following among the rabble, who, organized as the Working Men's Party, had polled 6,000 of the 20,000 votes in the election in 1829, had elected a member of legislature and had defeated the Tammany candidate. Clinton Roosevelt and his fellow Illuminati undertook to capitalize on the groundwork done for them by the licentious feminist emissary of the order from abroad. The boss of Tammany was prepared for the move and had arranged to have the gas lights in the hall turned off so as to leave the conspirators in darkness and close the meeting before they could carry out their scheme. But the conspirators came prepared for the maneuver. They came armed with the matches then in use, the local foco matches, and relit the gas lights so that the meeting could proceed. They thus earned for themselves the name Loco Foco Party. The Loco Focos posed as champions of the new social order, the New Deal, and of equal rights. They prated of their intent to kick the money lenders out of the temple and were opposed to monopolies. Masked by these noble and worthy causes that appealed to the moronic mentality of the peasants, the Illuminati of Loco Foco undertook to attain the dictatorship objectives laid down by Adam Weishaupt. Now, it is noteworthy, folks, that in their initial program, Roosevelt and his crew pretended that they were seeking to uphold the Constitution. In his book, The Science of Government, published shortly thereafter, Roosevelt frankly urged the gutting and abandonment of the Constitution, which he compared with a sinking ship. Roosevelt's Loco Foco did not succeed in their initial effort to impress Tammany Hall into their conspiracy. In the following year, Roosevelt and his fellow Illuminati organized a third party, an old and confirmed habit of the Roosevelt conspirators when they failed to get their wish, at a meeting held in their Masonic Hall. They nominated themselves as the candidates of the new party, the Whigs, following the bipartisan device dictated by Weishaupt, and now a familiar pattern of the conspirators. Roosevelt sought and obtained for himself and his crew the nominations of the Democratic Party at its Utica Convention held on September 15th in 1836. They thus aligned both the Whig and the Democratic parties as direct agencies of the Illuminist Communist Conspiracy. Bipartisanship is synonymous with the Illuminist Communist Conspiracy. The U.S. thus had what was in effect, if not in name, a communist dictatorship party fully three-quarters of a century before Russia dreamed of communism, and more than a decade before Moses Mordecai, Marx Levy, alias Heinrich Karl Marx, and Engels sought to duplicate in Europe the successes of their fellow conspirators in the United States of America. Now listen closely to what I'm giving you, ladies and gentlemen, and see if you find any parallels in the speech that I read to you earlier in this broadcast, given to the nation as the inaugural address of the second inauguration of William Jefferson Clinton. Emboldened by success, Roosevelt published in 1841 The Science of Government Founded on Natural Law. It embodies, as stated, Adam Weishaupt's pattern of organization of a one-world United Nations dictatorship as a blueprint of the New Deal, or New Social Order, that Roosevelt planned to impose on the United States of America as a part of the international conspiracy. This plan called for the gradual emasculation and eventual abandonment of the Constitution as a sinking ship. The Roosevelt book, in many of its passages, was quite patently a translation of Weishaupt's German and obviously plagiarized with slight modifications for American adaptation. In much the same manner, Moses Mordecai, Marx Levy, alias Karl Marx, 7 years later, with aid from America, plagiarized the blueprint of the complementary and derivative administrative aspects of Weishaupt's scheme and published it as his Communist Manifesto. These two publications taken together constitute the whole of Weishaupt's scheme for imposing a communist dictatorship on the world. It was no accident that the substance of the entire communist blueprint of Weishaupt's Illuminati was thus published internationally. World subjugation is of necessity an international affair. The internationalism dictated by Weishaupt and stressed by his disciple Roosevelt is essentially a conspiracy, treason. Members of the conspiracy are required to infiltrate their governments and to help their fellow Illuminist conspirators extend their infiltration to the point of taking over control of the governments. They are required to foster dissension between groups within nations and war between nations for the purpose of weakening existent governments. For the same purpose, they are required to bankrupt their governments and people by profligate waste and excessive taxation, and to betray their countries into the hands of their enemies. Above all else, they must place the wealth and resources of their countries at the disposal of the master conspirators for furthering the conspiracy in other lands. Roosevelt and his Illuminist henchmen carefully heeded Weishaupt's internationalist teachings. As soon as their efforts were crowned with success at home, they undertook to foster the conspiracy in Europe. Without their support, Illuminism might have died in Europe. Their instigation and support made possible the 1848 revolution in Europe and the subsequent stimulus to the conspiracy. Without the loco foco, Illuminist communist activities of Clinton, Roosevelt, and his clan, Karl Marx would have remained an obscure, demented German agitator. Charles A. Dana and Horace Greeley gave Marx and his plagiarized Communist Manifesto the international audience that was necessary to give them significance by employing their fellow Illuminist Marx as correspondent and columnist for their New York Tribune. As related by William Hale in his biography, Horace Greeley, Dana excelled himself in spreading the Illuminist communist ideas parroted by Marx and Engels, his ghostwriter, by plagiarizing parts of their articles and publishing the propaganda as his editorials. Without this early American support of Marx's Illuminism communism, his rise would have been as impossible as the latter rise of Lenin, Trotsky, and Stalin would have been without American support in the first and second Russian Revolution, which were, in fact, financed by New York Wall Street banking interests. Roosevelt proclaimed his adherence to Adam Weishaupt's Illuminism in the very title of his book. For though Weishaupt ordered that all arts, sciences, and religions should be abolished, he undertook to replace them by the social science of government, which is, in fact, socialist science of government, propounded by himself and pronounced by him to be the only true science. Weishaupt also dictated that it must be founded on natural law, which he alleged is the only true law. Plagiarist Roosevelt followed suit and wrote, "The science of government founded on natural law." Weishaupt ruled that, quote, "The superiors of the order of Illuminati are to be regarded as the most perfect and enlightened of men. They must not even permit any doubts of their infallibility," end quote. Roosevelt starts his science of government with a preface that is a testy dissertation on his superior wisdom and infallibility, that he orders shall not be questioned, and he demands that the whole world acquiesce in it. He scorns any pretense of modesty in his self-praise. He condemns his critics in advance for their ignorance and stupidity in failing to recognize his omniscience. And he demands that praise shall be heaped upon him from all corners of the world. This attitude, ladies and gentlemen, is the familiar Papa Knows Best attitude that is so characteristic of the Roosevelt Delano dynasty and their fellow conspirators. Copying Weishaupt, Roosevelt next proceeds to divide to rule by inciting class warfare, the most demoralizing form of civil war. He acknowledges that control and manipulation of money is the root of all the evils which he decries, but instead of attacking this root, which is the very device that he and his fellow Illuminists plan to use for the enslavement of mankind, he vaguely and fleetingly suggests kicking the moneylenders, who happen to be he and his kinsmen, out of the temple. He commiserates with the producer, the forgotten man. He professes that he feels so sorry for laborers that he wishes to regiment them and enslave them on an international basis. The power thus gained he plans to use to wage war on the workers, fellow victims of the dishonest monetary system, on their employers. He thus plans to usurp their property, regiment them under his dictation, and distribute their wealth in the direction of himself and his fellow conspirators. He plans to emasculate and destroy the Constitution, which he likens to a sinking ship, to make way for a dictatorship of his own devising. This dictatorship and the slavery that it entails, he labels a, quote, new social order, end quote. You see, folks, none of this is new, not at all. Roosevelt's dictatorship program is identical with the organization program described by Weishaupt for the carrying out of his Illuminist conspiracy for world control. Labor organization, the control, regimentation, and subversion of the masses was conceived by Weishaupt as a means of attaining power over the state, as well as a device for financing his conspiracy, and virtually all labor organizations since then has continued in control of the conspirators, vicious exploiters of labor who pose as labor leaders. The conspirators systematically take advantage of such eras of high employment and prosperity as their conspiracy permits to loot the workers by dues and assessments on the pretense that they have provided the higher wages that prosperity and a high level of employment have brought about, in spite of their malign, divisive activities. As a result, organized labor has been a captive of the subversive conspirators for more than a century. In their pose of friends of labor and labor leaders, they have cunningly used labor as their prime weapon in the war which they wage on the community year in and year out to enslave it together with labor. In the science of government, Roosevelt blueprints the regimentation of every phase of the community life in the pattern that has become so familiar to us in the so-called New Deal of his kinsman, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt. FDR and his fellow conspirators followed the blueprint of his kinsman so closely that the organization of the New Deal's NRA can be recognized clearly in the diagram published by Clinton in The Science of Government Founded on Natural Law. But present-day Roosevelts pretend they have no knowledge of Cousin Clinton or his book. Clinton Roosevelt's loco-foco activities spelled the conversion of the Democratic Party to the support of the Illuminist Socialist Communist Conspiracy. Bipartisanship resulted in the contamination of the opposition with the same affection. This has resulted in making Illuminist Socialist Communist doctrines and policies an integral part of American political thought and life. Thus, ladies and gentlemen, it is fully understandable that the Kremlin has always trusted the Roosevelts. It was quite meet that the USSR was prepared to honor the American dynasty that did so much to make possible its rise in the person of Eleanor Roosevelt. They offered to send an official plane to meet her at Helsinki when she announced her intent to visit the Soviets in July of 1954. This trip was part of a plan to align the subversive communist vote behind the candidacy of her two sons, Kiss and Tell Jimmy and Love 'em, Sock 'em, Leave 'em Franklin, who were prepared to execute a pincher movement on the nation from two continents separated, communist-infested sections of the country, in the furtherance of the Illuminist-inspired conspiracy. Queen Eleanor whom Hillary Clinton communicates as her spirit guide, spared herself the agony of sojourn in the conspirator Soviet paradise by making demands on her prospective hosts with which they could not comply. But it would be quite fitting that the Soviets bury her in the Kremlin in recognition of the role that she and her ancestors played in making possible the rise of communism and the Soviet Union. It would make many folks on this side of the Atlantic very happy. And it was quite in keeping with the character of the Roosevelts that Eleanor Roosevelt denied in a letter any knowledge of her distinguished kinsman Clinton Roosevelt, the author of the New Deal aspects of the conspiracy that was faithfully carried out by cousin Franklin Delano Roosevelt. How well the Roosevelts were aware of the progress of the conspiracy is evidenced by the prediction made by, or with the acquiescence of, Theodore Roosevelt in the late 1890s, that is cited by Owen Lister in his Roosevelt, The Story of a Friendship, Macmillan Company, 1930, page 51, as follows. Quote, "How long do you give the government at Washington to last?" I asked Theodore Roosevelt in Cabot Lodge as we sat lunching. Those two students and writers and makers of history, well versed in the causes which have led to the downfall of empires, kingdoms, and republics that have had their day and gone into the night, were both silent for a moment. Then one of them said, quote, "About 50 years," end quote, to which the two set this limit. I do not recall. I remember only that the other did not contradict him, end quote. Clinton Roosevelt, son of Albert Cornelius Roosevelt and Margaret R., was born on October the 3rd, 1804, and he died a bachelor at the ripe old age of 93 on August 1st, 1898. His entire life was dedicated to the furthering of the Illuminist Socialist Communist Dictatorship Conspiracy, the new social order that now parades as the New World Order. Although the words New World Order were not muttered in Clinton's inaugural address, it is the promise of a new land that he spoke of. It is the new covenant that he spoke of in his last inaugural address. And it is the same as the New Deal of which Franklin Delano Roosevelt saddled us with. The persistence of this political activity and of the propaganda's zeal is attested to by a long series of pamphlets and newspaper articles and books, which can be found everywhere, ladies and gentlemen. And they catalog, some or all, of what has happened over the years. It is absolutely amazing that Americans are, for the most part, I started to say so completely, but that's not true, for the most part, falling into this trap without any recognition whatsoever. And I believe that the success of that is because of the manner in which it is instituted a little at a time, so that it is almost unnoticeable when each of these steps are promulgated. But standing back and looking at it over a period of years, the difference is between night and day, between the constitutional republic and the freedoms that Americans once had and held, and the new socialist democracy which is being touted and foisted upon us today. You see, Americans who lived in this country as little as 40 years ago would not recognize, nor would they accept, the America of today. And you're probably sitting there scratching your head wondering, gee, why is that? It's because, ladies and gentlemen, the average person has an attention span of approximately 30 seconds, and that is why commercials are 30 seconds long. Most Americans have never and will never study history and therefore have no idea of what it is that has changed. They do not know that they have lost anything, for they never ever understood that they had it to begin with. And that is the real secret to all of this. Don't go away. I might be back.
All of a sudden, in the middle of the night, there's a loud knock on your door. Hey, honey. Something's not right.
Hold your hands.
This is the Voice of Freedom. Freedom Radio Network, with studios in Eager, Arizona, broadcasting on satellite GE1, transponder 7, worldwide, shortwave radio, 9955 kilohertz, Monday through Friday nights from 5 until 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Hour of the Time. I am William Cooper, and this is the second hour of today's broadcast, during which we will be accepting your calls. The number is 520-333-4578. What do you think about the inaugural address of William Jefferson Clinton and the socialist ideas which he attempted to disguise but was not very successful in doing it? He said an awful lot of things during that address, some of which you should have recognized in the recitation that I gave on Weishaupt's order, which is really a continuation where we left off in the broadcast series of that material. And he makes no bones about it. There is little that he likes about the history of this country or the Constitution for the United States of America or our form of government. He says everything must change. I agree with Mr. Clinton and everyone else who says that racism must end. I have been fighting against that terrible plague upon the human race for a good portion of my life. I agree that this should remain the land of opportunity, but I believe that it should be done in a different way. You see, I believe, ladies and gentlemen, I know that history supports my belief. Socialism destroys people. It destroys countries. It destroys self-esteem. It destroys dignity. It makes people dependent, and people who are dependent are in bondage. Whether they realize it or not, it is true. Socialism also levels all people to the same level and says, no matter how stupid or ignorant or dumb or non-productive you are going to be maintained and taken care of just like the most productive, most intelligent, most active contributor that there is here. I believe that that is destructive to both ends of that spectrum. You see, people who know that somebody is going to take care of them isn't going to do much for themselves. It is human nature to take the easy way out. People who love to be productive and love to excel and be active and produce and invent and manufacture in such a system never are rewarded for what they do. And therefore, after a while, they look around and say, why am I doing this? What is wrong with me that I am doing all of this and these other leeches are just sucking off of my productivity and taking everything and I get nothing for it except the satisfaction of having done it? Which in a socialist system is not recognized, because then that places one above another. You see, think about it.
Taken so much from so many as America's Illuminati and their warlords of Wall Street and Washington. In just 8 years, these banksters and international government gangsters took us from the greatest creditor nation to the largest debtor nation on earth. Our standard of living has dropped like a rock for 4 out of every 5 Americans. They foreclosed on our homes, our farms, our factories. They've exported your jobs and surrendered our arms. New World Order. New World Order.
Good afternoon or evening. You're on the air.
Is that me?
That's you.
Hey, God bless you, brother.
Thank you.
Time is close.
Yes, it is.
There's so much I'd like to say to you, but one thing I'd like to impart just immediately. Get the people who you're listening to your program, the listenership, just let them understand that if they go and tell a lot of other people, there's a multiplication factor. The numbers will take care of themselves. Just get them to listen to the program. Many of the people out there say, help us. What can I do? What can I do? I don't know what I can do. Believe me, this is the best thing that you can do. Get as many people as possible listening to the program. The numbers will take care of themselves. The creativity of God's people will take care of themselves. I don't want to take up too much time, but you're a great man. You're doing a wonderful work here, and it's just a shame that most of the people don't understand.
Well, thank you.
Okay.
I appreciate
that. Thank you very much. I'll keep in touch after the program.
Okay. And you are absolutely correct that the numbers will take care of themselves, but people have to hear what is happening. They have to understand. You would be amazed at how many socialists begin listening to this broadcast, hating my guts and thinking that I'm some kind of a weirdo out to destroy their utopian world. And after they listen for a while and become educated on the truth of what's really happening and the truth of what socialism really is and what we stand for here, they stop being socialists and once again become Americans. You see, because one thing that socialism doesn't tell them is that only in America can you have the freedom to be or think or do anything that you like. And once that is gone and socialism takes over, they can no longer be American, which means they can no longer be free. They can no longer be a socialist or whatever it is that they want to be. They then must be what the state tells them they have to be. And that really gets them going, because one of the first things that socialists hate in this country is for someone who infringes upon their constitutionally protected rights. And once they understand that if socialism ever comes to control in this country, they will have no more constitutionally protected rights. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, good evening. This is Mike out in LaBelle.
Hi, Mike. How are you?
I have to expound on the caller before and say, people, quit being cowards and put up an FM microtransmitter, and it'll do itself. And if you want to get more brave, do that like that lady does up in Michigan and start putting out about 100 watts.
That's not a lady.
Face.
Heather is a man.
Pardon?
Heather is a man.
Oh, I'm sorry.
He can't help the name his parents gave him. I kind of like that name, but...
Well, I didn't know.
Yeah, he's...
At any rate, I want to commend you on explaining... There was about an 18-minute explanation on your, New Year's Eve, where that caller called in. I think he was from Indiana. He was listening off the FM.
Uh-huh.
Big shock. I mean, so many people have heard that in my area here and have just opened up the thinking process and making them use their brain.
Well, that's wonderful.
I mean, that was a great explanation. I almost need to play it back for people. I'll let you go, Bill. Keep up the great work.
Thank you.
Bye.
And thank you for calling. 520-333-4578 is the number, and the rest of the hour we'll be taking your calls. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. How are you doing?
Good.
This is Tom from California.
Hi, Tom.
I really appreciate you reading Clinton's inauguration address on the air. I would have never heard it otherwise. Anytime the guy comes on, I term him as the anal orifice with teeth. I have to turn it off. I can't even listen to the guy.
Well, I don't blame you. He is a chronic liar, and that little smirk on his face just infuriates me. I've never understood how he can stand up there and talk about serious matters with this little smile like he's mocking us on his face. And that, maybe he is mocking us. I don't know. I don't pretend to understand where that comes from, but it is absolutely sickening. Like his attendance of the Ron Brown funeral. And upon leaving, he was mocking and joking with some of his friends, and all of a sudden he looked up and there was a television camera on him. And he knew that he had had it then, and all of a sudden he got this sad look on his face and put his fists up to his eyes and wiped his eyes like he was crying. What a phony! I mean, how can this man even look himself in the mirror?
Oh, I understand that. I saw that, too. And I believe that he is mocking us. I mean, any time you can get up in front of the American people, which, let's face it, the majority are constitutionally illiterate, and call them a democracy, as well as, you know, you might as well be saying, we're gonna start this new socialism here. And people are clapping and yaying. I mean, talk about sheep. I can't understand the American people. I really can't.
Yeah, some of his buzz phrases, a bright new prospect in human affairs, a global society, unleash the limitless potential of all our people, form a more perfect union. I thought that was done over 200 years ago.
It was, and I'll tell you what, from listening to your program from years now and picking up on all the secret societies and all the catchphrases and doing some research on my own, you could pick that speech apart.
Yeah. Our march to this new future, vowed then to set a clear course to renew our nation. Let me see. I can just go on and on and on and on.
Well, sure. Well, if you look at them, those people all in Washington, D.C., the District of Criminals, are all traitors. I mean, any time that you're going to openly admit that you want to change a constitutional republic to a socialist democracy, you're overthrowing the true government.
Sure. They're engaged in treason. There's no question about it.
Well, great show today, Bill, and I appreciate you, and I'll get off here and let somebody else get on.
Thank you. Thank you for calling. 520-333-4578 is the number. Here he says, today we can declare government is not the problem and government is not the solution. Well, what is government? You can't have it both ways. But you're right, government is not the problem. Our government is the supreme law of the land, the Constitution and the amendments thereto. And what is the problem are the people in government who are subverting the government from within, just like they always said that they would do. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello, Bill. This is Scott from Connecticut.
Hi, Scott.
I can barely hear your show. I'm going to have to get a satellite somehow.
Oh, you're listening on shortwave?
Yeah. I'm glad you're at least you're on in some way or fashion.
Barely hearing it is better than not hearing it at all.
Right. any chance, what's happened with Veritas? I subscribed last spring. I got 2 issues and...
We lost our staff in July. We have just put together another staff. They are producing issue number 15 as I speak, which should go to press the end of this month. And I mean right at the very end, so you could probably expect that issue in the mail sometime during February.
Okay, good. Would that update us on the things from the last few months and stuff, I assume?
Pardon?
So would it update us on what we, anything that we need covered for the last several months, I assume, because we didn't get a paper since then?
Well, it's going to have the usual quality and content that it's always had.
I was wondering, there's a TV show called The Simpsons, and one episode, Homer Simpson joined the Ancient Order of the Stonecutters. They patterned it after the Masons. It's pretty hilarious. Did you ever see that?
Yes, I did.
Okay, I was going to send you a copy, but...
I didn't see it when it aired. Somebody sent me a copy, as you were going to do, and that actually aired a long time ago.
Yeah. Another thing, I was at the State Public Law Library, and I was looking through some things in the North area on socialism. I looked through there, and I found a 1910 pamphlet of the National Socialist Party as it met in Chicago, and in the middle it said, meeting is held at the Masonic Lodge.
Yeah.
That just goes that there was like a lot of things you've been saying. Who was the name of that feminist lady you said gave speeches at Masonic Lodges?
I'd have to look in my notes again.
No big deal. I was listening to Clinton's speech, and I didn't hear any really blatant catchphrases. You're more just picking it in the mouth, but I heard him say part of the new millennium.
It's all through here. Listen to this lie. Listen to this lie. Our founders understood that well and gave us a democracy.
Oh, yeah.
They didn't give us a democracy. They gave us a constitutional republic. A democracy is what Lenin said is indispensable to socialism and leads ultimately to dictatorship.
And then the word comes from Greece, where in Greece they had a democracy, but it was there was a general, a military general in charge of every city?
Yes.
Yeah. And he made this point that democracy as opposed to dictatorship as though they're different.
Yeah. Well, they're not. Never have been different. Democracy always leads to dictatorship.
Right.
Listen to this, too. As times change, so government must change. We need a new government for a new century. We don't need a new government. We have the best government that's ever existed upon the face of the earth. What he's talking about, I guarantee you, nobody's going to want once they get it.
Yeah. Okay, I'll let you go, Bill. Thanks.
Thank you for calling. Yeah, there's buzz stuff all through here. This is the socialist tome. I mean, anybody who understands the symbolic language of the Illuminati and socialism and the mysteries would just love this speech. It's just it is rife with, well, good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, good evening, Mr. Cooper. Just enjoying your program today. This is Virginia over here in Texas. I thought it might be easier for the, for y'all to understand if you look up the true, what the true personality of a psychopath is. It's very clear that this is what Mr. Clinton is, and that smirk, that's, he's getting away with it.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a very interesting thing if people look up psychopathic personality to, on the fourth degree.
Yeah. And he talks about all through here about how the government must shrink, how it must be smaller, how it must do less, and all that kind of stuff. And then then he says down here, government should do more, not less.
Yeah, total contradiction. All right, well, I didn't watch any of it today. I just could not stand it. So, but it might help listeners understand what this man is if they look up what a psychopathic personality really is.
Yeah. Well,
thank you, Bill.
You're right. Thank
Bye.
You. Thank you very much, as a matter of fact. But, yeah, this is just amazing. The number is 520-333-4578 for those of you who may not know it or may just be tuning in for the first time and might like the call. We're taking calls for the rest of the hour. So if you want to jump in here, just call the number, 520-333-4578. It's just amazing, all this stuff. Embrace a new spirit of community for a new century. We are to succeed. We must succeed as one America. The challenge of our past remains the challenge of our future. Will we be one nation, one people, with one common destiny or not? Will we all come together or come apart? Well, it depends, Mr. Clinton. And it depends upon whether you and your socialist, illuminist friends are going to stop fomenting these Hegelian conflicts and leave us alone. Good evening. You're on the air.
Mr. Cooper.
Yes, ma'am.
I heard something that really was a bit shocking and wondered if you were aware of it. I was listening to Dr. Jack Vanenke, and he said that this June or July, I forgot which month, Gorbachev, he's all over the USA getting money from anybody he can, and he's probably really loading his pockets. But he and another couple of groups in July or June are going to start forming our new world religion. It is to be enforced by 2005. Do you know about this yet?
Well, I know that there is a new world religion coming, and I know that they've been in the process of forming it for a long time. And if you really pay attention, you see this happening all around you. Whether or not Gorbachev is going to put it together in June or July, no, I haven't heard that.
Well, they're beginning to work on it.
The work on it has been in progress for a long time. They're not beginning anything.
But what is Gorbachev doing in our country, doing such things? Why is he here, period?
Well, that's a good question. That's a question every American should be answering. And why was he given government quarters and government buildings to operate his One World Government Foundation?
I understand he's been going around helping us disarm, overseeing that we are disarmed.
Well, that's part of the treaty. I mean, I've done hours and hours of broadcast programs on the disarmament treaty and the Open Skies Treaty. Yes. Part of the treaty is the United States government has said there will be Soviet inspectors, Russian inspectors, here in the United States to supervise the disarmament of the United States of America. And the parties to the treaty can come and inspect any plant, any armament facility, any Navy, Army, or Air Force base, or overfly and take pictures of any of our supposedly secret facilities to make sure that we are disarming as we are supposed to be. This is no secret.
and yet they are not really disarming in Russia, are they?
That's right. They are not disarming in Russia and in the old Eastern Bloc nations, because if everything else fails to bring about the New World Order, it will be the military might of the old Soviet bloc that will be used to enforce the edicts of the coming world socialist utopian dictatorship.
Well, do you agree that in our country there's hundreds of thousands, possibly, foreign military-type people?
That I can't substantiate. I know that there are foreign military people here. I know that there are foreign immigrants here that may be military people here just waiting until the time is right for them to take their place as military personnel. I do know that there is an unbelievable number in the hundreds of thousands of Soviet bloc equipment, tanks, trucks, artillery, missile launchers, decontamination vehicles, etc., have been brought into the United States and are in storage in strategic locations around the country. If you want to know what that is for, go watch the movie Red Dawn, and that'll give you some idea.
Did you say Red Dawn?
Yes, that will give you some idea of what will happen if they are unable to bring about their new world order by peaceable means.
Well, thank you for being there.
You're welcome. Thank you for calling. 520-333-4578. Now, for people who haven't investigated any of this or done any of the research, some of this sounds off the wall, but it's not. And I urge you not to believe anything that I say. In fact, my constant admonition to my radio audience is to listen to everyone, read everything, believe absolutely no one unless you can verify it in your own research. And none of it is hard to do. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello.
Hello.
Bill?
Yes.
Hi, this is Jackie.
Hi, Jackie. How are you?
I'm fine. I don't have a real good connection. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I hear you fine.
Okay. Well, as far as I was concerned, the entire speech was basically doublespeak.
Mm-hmm.
But doublespeak today looks like it's becoming the language.
Of course.
And you mentioned it, and I caught it when he said we have to have a new government. And, of course, what he's talking about is eliminating or dismantling our Constitution. And God knows what would be put in place of it, the proposed Constitution for the new states of America or the World Charter or whatever.
Uh-huh.
But, and of course, there's still, you know, the push to open up our Constitution is still hot and heavy with their term limits. Initiative that they did last year. And there was something else he said, Bill, that I caught. He mentioned something about Social Security.
Uh-huh.
And he said something about that the grandparents, you know, that their future is assured, and now that the grandchildren know that their future will be. And I know they've been talking, there's been rumblings about them investing. I think the figure I've heard is 40% of the Social Security into the stock market. And if they do that, depending upon where they invest it, that would turn out to be, it appears to me, that the federal government would be the controlling stockholder of Wall Street.
Well, that could be. Yeah, it's a tremendous amount of money.
Well, I thought that, you know, that wasn't said innocently. And as far as just one more thing, the shrinking government, and they're constantly talking about this, and I think this is really, really important.
The government hasn't shrunk at all. It grows.
Yeah.
What they do is they phase out a program and tell you the shrinking government, and then they create twice the number of government bureaucrat jobs in some other place.
Yeah, in the States, because this is, I heard them over and over and over when I used to listen to C-SPAN about devolving power back to the States.
Mm-hmm.
And decentralizing.
Yeah,
and of course they started that back in the 70s when Nixon signed his executive order dividing us up into the 10 regions. They were power to the people is what they were screaming.
Sure, it's all regional.
And the shrinking of government is nothing really but the strengthening of the regional federal offices and all of the multi-state regions and sub-state regions that are forming today.
Yes.
And that was my three of the things that were that I thought were very important.
Well, they are very important, and
okay.
People need to know about those things.
Thanks, Bill.
Thank you for calling.
Mm-hmm.
And for those of you who don't know, Jackie Petru is the host of the Jackie Petru program, which airs every night at 6 p.m. Pacific, 7 Mountain, 8 Central, and 9 Eastern Standard Time on the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network, right here on the same station. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Mr. Cooper.
Yes.
I'm Jackie from Mentor, Ohio. Hi. I'd like to know why President Bill Clinton was inaugurated on the east side instead of the west side of the Capitol building like all the other presidents before President Reagan.
Because the master of the lodge sits in the east, and the light arises and the golden dawn behind his throne. That's why. You have to understand the mysteries and the ceremonies of the lodge, of all of the fraternal organizations that make up the sum total of the Illuminati at the highest levels. That's why. They believe in the light bringer. Lucifer is their god, the god of this world, secular humanism. They believe that the god of the Bible is a terrible, vindictive, and unjust God, and that Lucifer set man free from the Garden of Eden with his gift of intellect when he seduced Eve into eating of the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and that the promise of Lucifer will come true through the use of man's intellect. He will become as God.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
How about that? Was that what you wanted to know?
Yeah.
I bet it wasn't what you wanted to know. But it happens to be the truth.
Okay, I have another question.
Sure.
Could you explain the Book of the Dead?
The Book of the Dead? Are you talking about the Egyptian Book of the Dead?
Yeah, Book of the Dead.
Have you got a few hundred hours?
No, but could you explain a little bit of it?
No. I've done that in the series on Mystery Babylon. You can purchase that on tape if you want. But you cannot explain in 5 minutes or an hour what takes a tremendous amount of time to research and explain at all. It's impossible.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay, bye.
Thank you for calling. 520-333-4578. Yeah, I've done a huge series on the symbolism and the beliefs and the religion of the secret fraternal orders that at the highest levels make up the Illuminati, and what they are about and how they are doing it and who belongs and all of that kind of stuff. And it's an ancient religion. This never changed. Good evening. You're on the air. Hello. Goodbye. 520-333-4578 is the number. If you're going to call, folks, don't be afraid to talk. I won't bite you. I don't know who you are. There's no harm that I could possibly do to you whatsoever. There's no need to be afraid or fearful. You're the only one that knows who you are. And even if I did jump on you, you're the only one who knows that I did it. Good evening. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello. I can barely hear you.
Well, there's nothing I can do about that.
Okay. This is your young friend that spent part of New Year's with you.
What can I do for you today?
Well, I heard that I heard myself mentioned earlier, and if I was a catalyst for any kind of wake-up call for people out there, then I'm glad.
Well, great.
I hope that it wasn't my stupidity juxtaposition next to your wisdom, because I feel pretty stupid if that's what it was.
Well, I don't think it could be called stupidity. It could be called ignorance. There's no shame in ignorance. Ignorance simply means that you've never had the opportunity to have the information or have never known about it or been taught the truth. Stupidity is having been presented with the information and your mind is so feeble that you're not able to comprehend or do anything with it.
I see.
There's a big gulf between the two.
By the way, I did some checking. Remember I told you about that thing called Unigov?
Yes.
Remember, you said, well, we don't know anything about that. Maybe that'd be something you could check. Well, anyway, what I found was that it's a merging of county and city governments.
Okay.
And what that does is, more or less, in practice, it lays the groundwork for the open door of multi-jurisdictional task force to come in and more or less do away with the...
Well, it opens the door for the whole control of local government by regionalism, mm-hmm. and destroys the very basis of political power in this country, which is the county political structure.
The sheriff.
And it does away with the senior law enforcement official elected by the people, which is the sheriff of every county in this country.
Mm-hmm.
People don't know it, but the sheriff is the most powerful law enforcement person in the United States of America at any level.
That's right. He's a stopgap to some of this. If some of them knew, I don't even think that in my little town they even know, you know.
Well, most people don't know. Most Americans don't know anything about America or its history or its founding principles and ideals or its political structure or why it was set up that way and how it's being destroyed.
Mm-hmm. Sir, I wanted to ask you a question. This is a type of military question. Over the weekend, I don't live too far from an airport, and I saw what looked to be, I don't know what kind of helicopter this is.
I'm sorry, but this is totally inappropriate. Unless I saw it, I cannot give you any interpretation of what you're talking about.
Okay.
Because I didn't see it. And it's as simple as that. So, anyway, thanks for your call.
Okay, thank you.
520-333-4570. Don't ask me to interpret something that you saw and I did not, ladies and gentlemen. I can't do that. I don't have a crystal ball. You may be explaining or interpreting what you saw okay according to your interpretation or what you believe you saw, but that may not be what you saw at all. You know, if a bank robbery occurs and you're able to go and get testimony from all of the witnesses who were there and saw it, you'll find that each one of them saw something different. So unless I saw it myself and used my powers of observation to make sure that I was objective and recorded the information correctly, I can't interpret for you what you saw. Good evening. You're on the air.
Bill.
Yes.
This is Dave from Iowa.
Hello, Dave.
After the inauguration speech today, I was listening to the shortwave, and one of the programs, some guy called in and said that when they did the swearing in on the Bible, when Clinton put his hand on the Bible, this guy says that they did a pan shot on it, apparently, and Clinton actually never touched the Bible. There was a piece of paper with some symbols on it that he couldn't tell what they were. It's between his hand and the Bible.
Wouldn't surprise me a bit, but without some kind of proof, that must be understood by the listening audience at this point to be rumor.
He said it was on there. I missed that.
Well, that doesn't,
they showed it on there.
That doesn't mean a thing.
Yeah, well,
just like I tell my listening audience, you know, don't even believe what I say. Don't believe what your mother says. Because somebody says something does not make it true. Although it sounds like something Clinton would do, it still does not make it true, no matter who said it.
Now, somebody probably even need a tape of it so you can take a look at it.
Yeah, that's what we need. We need absolute proof on this broadcast before we make any assertions about anything whatsoever.
Yeah, I missed that part.
That's what makes this the premier broadcast in America, if you want to know the truth.
Okay. Thanks, Bill.
You're welcome. Thank you for calling. 520-333-4578 is the number. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello, Bill?
Yes.
Richard from California.
Hello, Richard. What can I do for you? Turn off your radio.
Damn, television mute isn't hitting.
And watch your language on my program.
Interesting that he mentions the government can't get people to read, and yet in this state they're spending $26 billion a year on government schools to try to teach them to read.
Yeah, these socialists think that the more money and the more bureaucracy you attach to something, the better it will turn out, and that is not true. If you take the little old red schoolhouse with the teacher supported by the community, and told by the community what was expected of her or him and what level of education they wanted the students to have, they gave her or him a place to live, and an allowance for food and clothing, and a little bit left over, not much, to spend. And those teachers in that era outperformed anything that the public school system has ever attempted in its entire history.
By far. The previous caller can get the information on helicopters through the military book club, and they have one on Jane that has every helicopter that was ever manufactured, and it's easy to identify them in that manner.
Great.
One other thing, have you heard that Maynard Campbell had been murdered in prison?
No.
That came across Roger Fredberg's program last night, so nice talking with you.
Thank you for calling. And remember, folks, what he just said about Maynard Campbell is a rumor unless it is substantiated with documentation and proof. And we don't pass along rumor on this broadcast. So, and also bear in mind that most of what you hear on all other radio shows and most of what you get passed along through the rumor bill or the Patriot Facts Network or your buddies that you meet with on the weekend to discuss what's going on in the world is patently fake, false, disinformation, or just outright lies. We did an experiment one time. We collected all of the information that we could from the Patriot Facts Network, and it was going around through these organizations and clubs and being passed from person to person. And we sat down and we got on the phone and we went to the library and we went to the Federal Depository Libraries and documented what we could out of all of it. And we found that over 95% of every bit of it was just a flat, total lie. It was not authentic, was fake, fraudulent. Even so-called official-looking government documents turned out to be fake. So, folks, remember that, you know, just because somebody says it does not make it true. Just because it's on a piece of paper that looks official does not make it official, does not make it real, does not make it genuine. You must work. You must do work to discover the truth. And since we know that most people do not like to do work, we know that that's the reason why most of the crap that flies around from hand to hand and mouth to mouth and fax to fax is total, absolute BS, crap, phony, fraudulent, fake. Simply because nobody in that whole chain ever stops to check any of it out. Doesn't that make you feel good? Well, it shouldn't. You should feel very bad about that. Let's do this. I'll be right back after this short pause. Maybe.
Thank you.
by Swiss America Trading. They specialize in real money, hard assets, non-confiscatable, non-reportable, hard assets. Gold and silver coin. They also have platinum and all kinds of other precious metals, depending upon what you particularly need. But we recommend gold and silver coin because it is recognized throughout the world amongst all peoples as real money, and in fact is the only real money, is the only constitutional money, and is the only lawful money according to the laws of the United States of America. You see, a dollar is a specific measurement by law in weight and purity of silver coin, or an equivalent value in gold. And you see, in the Constitution, it gives Congress the power to coin money, not print it. Most Americans don't understand these things. It specifically says in the Constitution, no state shall tender anything in payment of debt other than gold or silver coin. Where is it? Who's doing it? If the Constitution is the supreme law of the land, this is a great indication that it is not in force. And it is not. It has been subverted a long time ago, and the illusion that it is in force is maintained in order to prevent a revolution in this country, which would surely have occurred a long time ago had the American people had the education in order to be able to understand what has happened and what is going on and where we are being propelled. President Clinton likes to talk about obeying the law, yet he and his bureaucratic lackeys in this socialist government don't obey the law. If you don't believe that, just get out a copy of the Constitution and read it sometime. It's not very long. It's only 7 articles. Once you've done that, then you can wait another few days or another week or two and sit down and read all of the amendments to the Constitution and make sure that you read the preamble to the Bill of Rights, because without it, you don't really understand why the Bill of Rights was written in the first place. 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646, or if you prefer, if it's easier, 1-800-BUY-COIN. Do it now. You'll be glad that you did. Great weight will come off your shoulders, and you'll be taking care of business. To the hour of the time, I'm William Cooper. We're taking calls for the remainder of the hour, and the number is 520-333-4578. That's 520-333-4578. Listen to this, ladies and gentlemen. Here's what Clinton said this afternoon, or should say, whenever he said it. I don't really know what time that he said it. Listen to this. The American people returned to office a president of one party and a Congress of another. Surely they did not do this to advance the politics of petty bickering and extreme partisanship they plainly deplore. No, they call all of us instead to be repairers of the breach and to move on with America's mission. The truth is, ladies and gentlemen, that the socialist plan to put Clinton back in office was the creation of all of these third parties, including Ross Perot, who was working toward that goal. Ross Perot is on record as having said that the Constitution is old and outdated and must be replaced. That's the truth. They so split the conservative vote that Clinton was reelected. Clinton has no mandate. If the American people really wanted to repair things and do it right, they would have put one party in both the presidency and the Congress. And that's the truth of the matter. Instead, we have a Democrat president and a Republican Congress. But it wouldn't have made any difference if you had elected Bob Dole to the presidency. We would have had the same march to the New World Order, for Bob Dole is a 33rd degree Freemason of the southern jurisdiction of the Scottish Rite. And that's the truth, and that's why Bill Clinton gave him the Freedom Medal, which is the highest civilian medal that could be given to anyone, for playing his role very well. And, you know, this whole thing is just amazing to me. I watch it go on, and sometimes I laugh and sometimes I cry. Good evening, you're on the air. Hello? Well, if you're going to call, folks, when we answer the phone, stay on the line. 520-333-4578 is the number. Don't fail to get your 2 cents worth in here. Did you hear the inaugural address? If you did, what do you think about it? And why? Good evening, you're on the air.
Bill.
Yes.
Doing a hell of a job out there.
Turn off your radio. Folks, I don't know why everybody on radio has to keep continually telling you this. When you call a station, always turn your radio off.
Okay, I apologize. You're doing a hell of a job out there. You sound good on satellite tonight. Can't pick you up very well out here in North Carolina on short wave.
Well, since the station is in Florida, there may be a skip over certain areas that are close to the station, but you should get it pretty well in North Carolina. There is, however, an awful lot of sunspot activity, solar storms, and bad propagation this year for all of radio, not just shortwave.
Well, just keep up the good work, my friend, and God bless you and your family.
Thank you. Did you hear the president's speech today?
No, I did not. I wasn't home from work in time.
Did you hear my reading of it?
Just now?
Earlier in the broadcast.
I didn't get you until about 6:30, actually.
Okay, well, you missed most of it.
I have it on tape, so I'll go back and go over it again.
Good.
All right.
Okay, thank you for calling.
Thank you.
The number is 520-333-4578. When you call, folks, please turn off your radio. When we pick up the line here, you'll be able to hear everything perfectly. If you're listening to a radio, however, there's a delay. And the feedback in my ears is terribly destructive, believe me. 520-333-4578. I want to know, what did you think of the president's speech and why? Did you catch the symbolism? Did you catch the socialist ideals and principles that he was enumerating throughout? Did you catch the part about we need a new government? And if not, why not? I mean, why is it that these things fly over the heads of most Americans and they don't understand it? Good evening, you're on the air. Hello?
Yeah, Rich Cooper, this is Jerry in New Mexico.
Hello, Jerry.
I was curious if anybody else noticed whenever Mr. Clinton was giving his oath of office, he left out the part about defending against both domestic and foreign enemies. But as I understand it, Mr. Gore did not leave that out.
That's interesting. I'm going to have to get the tape and listen to it. We have people who taped it, and so I will ultimately get a tape to view and be able to watch and listen to. But I can't make any comment because I didn't see it.
Well, I saw it, and I have it on tape. If you don't have one, and if it doesn't, don't have one forthcoming, you've got my listed, unlisted number. If you'd call me, I'll certainly send you one.
Okay. Thank you.
What
I would prefer, though, folks, is just whenever you have something you think is important and that I should see, don't wait for me to call and ask for it. Just send it. Make a copy or whatever you have to do and just send it. It doesn't matter if we get 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 or 20 copies of the same thing. That means we can take the extras and make sure that other important people who are helping in this effort also get a copy.
Okay, I'll just get one and send it in your direction.
Great. Thank you very much.
Take care, sir.
I really appreciate that. 520-333-4578. No, I didn't hear it and I didn't see it. And if that's true, that is significant because it means if he did not take that oath, if he did not execute that portion of the oath, then he is not required to carry it out. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is significant. I mean, extremely significant. But don't take it as gospel fact. unless you can confirm it for yourself. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello, Mr. Cooper.
Hello.
Yeah, this is Charlie from New York.
Hi, Charlie.
Hi, I just wanted to agree with your last caller there about the oath.
Mm-hmm.
I did watch it. I watched the whole thing all the way through the parade and whatnot. And it was true. I did notice it, and I was amazed by it.
He did not say he would protect and defend the Constitution against all enemies, foreign and domestic?
No, he didn't.
Wow.
Gore did, but he didn't.
Gore did, but he didn't. This is significant, ladies and gentlemen, and it is also extremely dangerous. Extremely dangerous.
I did notice several other things.
You see, now it becomes something you can listen to because it has come from two independent, unconnected witnesses. Now it becomes information that you can listen to. We still advise you to verify it for yourself, but it is much more credible now than it was a few moments ago.
I also picked up where he said that the human spirit was the greatest instead of the Holy Spirit.
Well, that is the New World religion that's coming. The
right.
Humanist religion that man himself is God.
Right. That's got to do with Hinduism, doesn't it?
Well, it has to do with an awful lot of things. It doesn't matter where it came from. It's just patently wrong. Man is not God, never has been God, never will be God. That was the promise of Satan
right.
in the Garden of Eden. It is the Luciferian philosophy. It is totally in opposition to everything that Christianity teaches.
I agree with a lot of what you say, and God bless you and your work.
God bless you, too.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for calling.
Bye-bye.
And I like the way you said that. I don't like people who try to kiss up to me. And no one is required to believe everything that I say or believe. The only thing that I really want you to do from this broadcast is learn how to think for yourself and verify information for yourself. Because if you can do that, no matter how much you and I personally might disagree, our future will be much brighter. We will be living in the light of truth, and we will be able to, together, hopefully, bring about a future that is steeped in truth and knowledge. And that is what is important. That is the most important thing in the world. We cannot live our lives in fantasy. We cannot be misled by leaders anymore who lie to us all the time and promise that they will take care of us if we just keep our nose out of their business. We must have our nose in their business because their business is our business, and that's what you must understand. Seek ye the truth, and the truth will make you free. My people perish for lack of knowledge, and I could go on and on and on and on and on. You see, without truth, you are not living. Without truth, you are enslaved by the lies to which you subscribe. And that is the truth. And that is what you must understand. Okay, folks, good night. God bless each and every single one of you, and may God save this republic. Let me try that again. You see, folks, I make mistakes, and that's why you must check on everything. This time it was just with a CD selection. Next time it might be with something more important. Here's what I wanted to close out with, and here's what you should hear.
This ain't coming from no prophet. Just an ordinary man. When I close my eyes, I see the way the world shall be. Yeah.
Is the voice of freedom. With studios in Eager, Arizona, broadcasting on satellite GE1, transponder 7, 7.56 audio, and over 700 FM stations across the nation and around the world. The Hour of the Time is also carried on WRMI, Worldwide Shortwave Radio, 99.55 kilohertz, Monday through Friday nights from 5 until 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We now return you to all oldies most of the time. Classic radio, the way you always wished it could be. 101.1 FM, Eager.